ومن أحسن قولا ممن دعا إلى الله وعمل صالحا وقال إنني من المسلمين.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته، and welcome to another session of Mothers of the Believers. Alhamdulillah, we have been able to cover so far the lives of Khadija bint Khuwaylid, Sauda bint Zam'a, Aisha bint Abi Bakr, حفصة بنت عمر، زينب بنت خزيمة، أم سلمة رضي الله عنهن أجمعين. And today, inshallah, we are going to do the life of زينب بنت جحش رضي الله عن mothers of the believers, inshallah, who got married to رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم in the fifth year of Hijra at around the age of 35-36. Now, before we talk about her marriage to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of course we have to talk about her marriage to Zayd ibn Harith radiallahu an. And before that, I think quickly we want to remind ourselves of the chaos, the social chaos that existed in the pre-Islamic Arabian society, in the Jahili society, and how Islam came and put into place certain practices and measures to put an end to that chaos. The chaos that existed in terms of marriage, in terms of divorce, in terms of family relationships, name it, it was all there, right? So through the marriage of Zainab bint Jahash radiallahu anha to Zayd ibn Harith radiallahu an and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, two major societal flaws, social flaws were addressed that are basically the legacy of the Jahili society, right? You know, social habits, they are difficult to shrug off. They're difficult to dust off. Like, they have a hold on people. And we know that from personal experiences, culture, norms, etc. You know, you just don't get rid of them, or you just don't grow out of them overnight, right? So yes, a mandate was given that adoption is prohibited in Islam, but a practical demonstration of that fact was needed for the community in order to firmly establish it, in order to annul the act of adoption itself. So through the marriage of Zainab radiallahu an to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to Zayd ibn Harith radiallahu an, two societal flaws, like I said, two social flaws are addressed. One is the concept of tabanni. What is tabanni? We're going to talk about it in a little bit. And the other one is, and this was addressed particularly through the marriage of Zainab with Zayd ibn Harith radiallahu anhuma, and that is marital hierarchy, right? Or classism, or the unspoken class distinction that existed in that society, that was actually not just existent in that society, but it was deep rooted, and how Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put various measures and practices in place to basically eliminate that custom that was that reflected racist attitude, right? So inshallah, we're going to look into that. Two things, like I said, two things. One is through the marriages. One is the concept of tabanni, and the second is the marital hierarchy that existed in that community, right? So first, adoption. Tabanni, the main, loosely translated in English as adoption for lack of a better word. But when we talk about tabanni, right, and when we try and understand tabanni and the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed ayahs like we have in Surah Ahzab, ayah number 4, and also in ayah number 5, it related to Zayd ibn Harith radiallahu an, we know that he was the adopted son of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was given the name Zayd ibn Muhammad. And this, of course, takes place before the coming of Islam, right? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Ahzab, He establishes that simply by uttering words, okay? Simply by uttering words or calling someone your son, that person does not become your son. And that's ayah number 4 in Surah Ahzab. بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وما جعل أبيعكم. Though he does not make the ones you call your sons, أبناءكم, your sons. It does not work that way, right? And in ayah number 5, he says, أدعوهم لآبائهم. Call them by their fathers' names. One of the principal purposes of Sharia, the maqasid of Sharia, is preservation of lineage. And it is very important. In the Jahili society, right, adoption was one of the practices, or tabanni was one of the practices that was misused. For example, in order to cover zina or justify zina, right? This was one of the ways by which adoption was practiced in the Jahili society. Now, in order to preserve the lineage, and we know how much emphasis Sharia places on the lineage of a person, in order to preserve the lineage, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed from the heavens that you cannot apply the rules of biological relationship to adopted relationships. Okay, I'll repeat that again. You cannot apply the rules of biological relationship to adopted relationship. And that is basically what the prohibition of adoption entails. It did not mean that Zayd bin Haris radiallahu anh, after these ayahs that were revealed, he's not going to be called Zayd ibn Muhammad anymore. Yes, that was a fact. But it did not mean that he would be removed, or he would be leaving the care and the compassion and the kindness of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We know taking care of an orphan is one of the highest things in Islam. There is no deed that is more encouraged than taking care, than being the kafil of an orphan, right? So we see, and there are various ahadith of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam that establish that fact. But as this society was being established, the new society that was being established in Medina, it needed to be one of the fundamental reforms that needed to be take place was at the level of family. All right, and everybody should know, because everybody has the right to know where they're coming from and who they belong to, who their father was. That's the birthright of everyone, right? So in keeping this in mind, the practice of adoption became prohibited. Again, the prohibition only entails that you no longer are able to apply the rules of biological relationships to adopted relationships. All right, and Zayd ibn Haris is now Zayd ibn Haris. He no longer can be called Zayd ibn Muhammad. And in order to establish this, right, in order to practically establish this, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam was commanded to marry, right, commanded to marry the divorcee of his former adopted son Zayd ibn Haris, and that is how the marriage with Zainab radiallahu anha takes place. And we'll get to that in a little bit, but first, before we get to that, we have to talk about the marriage with Zayd. How did that happen? Zainab radiallahu anha, she is a Qurayshiya, right? And she is the paternal cousin of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Her mother was the paternal aunt, Umayma bint Abdul Muttalib. She was the paternal aunt of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We don't know much about her father. We don't know if her parents accepted Islam. We know this fact that Zainab radiallahu anha was from the early converts to Islam, along with her brothers, right? Ubaydullah ibn Jahash and Abdullah ibn Jahash. Ubaydullah ibn Jahash, we know that he was a Hanif, meaning he was from the likes of Waraqa bin Nawfal, and then he also migrated to Abyssinia. But Allah knows best. It is said that he parted ways with Islam once in Abyssinia, and he died as a Christian. Again, Allah knows best what happened with him, but this is what we know about him. And then Abdullah ibn Jahash, the other brother of Zainab bint Jahash, his name comes up most often when we talk about the events that led to the Battle of Badr. right? And then he participated in the Battle of Uhud. He also died as a martyr in the Battle of Uhud. Zainab radiallahu anha's real name was Barra, and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam changed it to Zainab because it meant someone who is extremely pious, and he was not fond of names that declared somebody's piety or righteousness. So that's why he changed that name. Zainab radiallahu anha, like we said, got married to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the 5th year of Hijrah, but before that she was married. So maybe about a year before that, she gets married to Zayd ibn Harith. Prior to Zayd ibn Harith, was she married to anybody else? Well, some reports mention that maybe she was married to the husband of maybe she was married, we don't know if she was married to anyone, but if, or maybe she was married, but we don't have reports about that. So at the age of around 34 or 35, she gets married to Zayd ibn Harith. And how does that marriage take place? Now, like we said, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he came with the message of Islam to a society that was in complete chaos in terms of social norms. So classism existed there, right? One of the flaws that existed in that society was marital hierarchy, right? So marriages, they happened, they looked at classes, they looked at the rank in society, the tribe that anyone belonged to. It is okay to check all that, but then when that becomes the criteria that you are looking down upon somebody, then that is problematic. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam wanted to establish the fact that everyone in society is equal. And one of the ways, or one of the measures, one of the practices that he put in place was through marriage of someone who was considered to be from the lower strata of society and someone who was considered to be from the higher strata of society. So he made possible those unions, or he encouraged those unions. And Zainab bint Jahash and Zayd ibn Harith radiallahu anhuma is one such example. And we see many other examples, like we see the case of Sa'd ibn Aswad as-Sulami. Subhanallah, due to his inferiority complex, because of his blackness, he was looked down upon in that society, right? So he was a slave, and because of his inferiority complex, he comes to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam one day and he says, like, will I be able to enter Jannah because of my low status? Subhanallah, just think about the treatment that he was subjected to that made him think or ask that question. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam not only comforted him, but he also encouraged him to go ask for the go ask to Amr ibn Wahhab, his daughter's hand in marriage. Right? He was a noble from the tribe of Banu Thaqif. Yes, there was resistance in the beginning, but eventually the marriage happened. So this is one example. And then we have another example where we see Julaybib radiallahu anhu, the deformed one, who Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he encouraged him to get married to, or he sent the proposal for Julaybib to the daughter of a wealthy and a noble Ansari man, right? Yes, there was resistance there too. We know how the mother reacted to when the proposal came for her daughter. But eventually the marriage happened, right? So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam encouraged such unions, and the purpose was to communicate to the community, the newly formed Islamic community, that everyone is equal in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the only thing that can distinguish one from the other is taqwa and good deeds. Now, he wanted to attack this virus, if you want to say, of classism, right? Unspoken classism that existed in the society within his family as well. All right. So that's why he went to Zainab bint Jahash, who was his cousin, right? And he asked her, or he recommended, or he proposed marriage to her on behalf of Zayd ibn Harith. Right? And how did Zainab radiallahu anha respond to Rasul's proposal for Zayd ibn Harith? Now, initially, when Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam went there, Zainab radiallahu anha actually thought that he had come to propose marriage between him and her, right? But of course, that was not the case. And when he mentioned Zayd ibn Harith, she resisted. She didn't take it lightly, right? She was sharp-tongued. She's our mother. And of course, you know, again, all this goes to just capture the humanity of our role models, right? So she, when Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, you get married, I brought you a proposal for Zayd, she said, no, I'm not going to get married to him. And then Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, no, you should get married. And then she's like, Don't I have a choice in this matter? As this dialogue was going on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals the ayah which we see in Surah Ahzab, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and this is ayah number 36, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ. It is not befitting for a male believer or a female believer. إِذَا قَضَ اللَّهُ وَالرَّسُولُهُ أَمْرًا. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger have decided a matter, that they should express their will in that matter. Subhanallah, you know, no one is forced to get married. Everybody has a say in who they want to get married to and who they should get married to. This is there, right, for everyone. But when an ayah from the Quran is revealed, right, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the command is coming from the skies, then what are you going to do? You have to submit to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's exactly what Zainab bint Jahash radiallahu anha did. Even though she initially resisted, then finally she said to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if this is what has come from the skies, then there has to be a reason behind this. Radith, I accept this marriage, and I am willing to get married. And then of course the marriage happened. So through this marriage of Zayd radiallahu an and Zainab radiallahu an, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was beginning to bring down social barriers. Okay, and like we see in other instances as well. So hers is not the only case. She's the one from family. Okay, so there the marriage happens. Now, the marriage was troubled right from the beginning. They didn't get along at all. The marriage lasted for about a year. And Zayd radiallahu anhu would constantly complain to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about, it's just not working, right? So he goes to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at one point, and you know, as if like just throwing in the towel. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that time, he says, amsik alayha, hold on to her, wattaqillah, like do not divorce her, don't end this relationship yet. What had happened was, before we go further from here, what we need to know is that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after the marriage of Zayd radiallahu anhu to Zainab radiallahu anhu, through wahi, he was informed that Zayd radiallahu anhu will eventually divorce Zainab radiallahu anhu. All right, that he's eventually going to divorce. And this is that this marriage is not going to last. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, through wahi, he was given that knowledge. So when Zayd radiallahu anhu came, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was aware of this fact, but still he said, amsik alayha, right? He still, he even though he had the knowledge, I mean, he didn't say to her, go ahead, divorce her, right? So when he didn't, despite having the knowledge, and it is like he concealed that knowledge, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately reveals an ayah where he says, after he says, amsik alayka zawjak wattaqillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wattukhfi fi nafsik, and you are hiding in yourself what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to bring in the open anyways, right? And that is what? That she is going to be your wife eventually. That Zainab bint Jahash radiallahu anh is going to be divorced by Zayd radiallahu anh, and then Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going to get married to her. Anyways, the divorce finally takes place. Zayd divorces Zainab radiallahu anh, and then once, and like the ayah mentions, falamma qada Zaydun minha watran, when this, I'm not translating literally, but what it means is that when the idda period was over and now she is a free woman, right? Meaning free woman to get married. At that time, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he calls Zayd. All right, he calls Zayd and he sends the proposal for Zainab through Zayd. Think about it. If there was any malice involved here, right? Or if Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, na'udhu billah, was manipulating this situation, he would not have involved Zayd in this matter, right? So he calls Zayd, and Zayd then is actually the one who takes the proposal to Zainab. Once he takes the proposal to Zainab, Zainab is so excited, she immediately falls into sajda, and she responds to Zayd by saying that, I have to do salatul istikhara. All right, and then I will give you my answer. So Zayd goes back, and in the meantime, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals an ayah to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by saying, zawajnakaha. We have married you to her. So this is one marriage of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam that takes place without a wali. Yani the wali is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It takes place without any paperwork. There is no, it's not a gathering of people, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself facilitated this marriage. The nikah was done in the skies, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then revealed this to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then when he goes to Zainab radiallahu anha, Zainab radiallahu anha asks, okay, what about the nikah? What's happening? When is it happening? She's asking about the plans. Of course, she has said yes. And at that time, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, Allah has already married you to me. Right? As believers, you know, we take whatever is there in the Quran, and our test, like we said, is in belief in the unseen, right? This is the test. Now, this is what the Quran is saying. This is how the marriage has taken place. Whether we understand any other wisdom, or whether there is any other reason explaining how this marriage took place, it's irrelevant to us as believers. As believers, we submit. This is mentioned in the Quran. What else do we want, right? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that he has married Zainab to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the discussion ends there. This is a matter of great controversy till today. People pick on this situation, and they can pick on it as much as they want. It does not change the fact. It does not change who Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam is. It does not change the status of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam or his rank. Right? At the end of the day, each one of us will stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we will account for our words, we will account for our actions. So we leave whoever, whatever their opinion is, we leave them to be, right? And we know what is true. And we know that this has come in the Quran, therefore this seals the matter for us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the purpose of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam's marriage to Zainab bint Jahash, if we don't understand anything, if we don't understand that the prohibition of adoption had to be solidified, that annulment had to be sealed, if we don't understand that, if we don't understand that this marriage was a practical demonstration of the fact that the rules of biological relationship do not apply to adoptive relationship, it was a jahili custom that a father-in-law was not able to marry his former daughter-in-law. This is a jahili, through adopted son. This mahramiya is established only through blood and marriage. Okay? Now, mahramiya in today's times, in our Sharia, a father-in-law, he cannot get married to his former daughter-in-law. Daughter-in-law, his real daughter-in-law, the father's real son that the lady was married to. That mahramiya remains. But adopted son, your adoption is through utterance of few words. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? وَمَا جَعَلَ أَذِيَعَكُمْ أَبْنَاكُمْ. Your words are not going to become your sons. And this was a social custom, like I said, in the pre-Jahili society, and social habits, they don't just die away, right? This needed to be practically established, and the only person who can do that or who could do that was Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So you can imagine, as a human being, even it was not easy for him. It was not easy for him to get married to the wife, to the divorcee of his adopted son, former adopted son. He was human at the end of the day, right? But someone had to do it, and there was no one else who could do it better than Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He had to bear this burden, right? And like I said, if we don't understand anything else, the fact that it was a command from the skies, that it was divine, that's sufficient for us, and we move on from there. All right. So this is how the marriage of Zainab radiallahu anha takes place with Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. She has a walima after that, and it is said that her walima was the most expensive walima. There was bread, there was meat, there was dessert in it, and there were about 300 people in attendance. Zainab radiallahu anha, she used to always say to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam that she is above all the other wives because of three reasons. One is that Allah himself facilitated her marriage to him. Second is that she is his family. She was his cousin. And the third is that she is the concealed one. According to reports, the ayahs of hijab for the mothers of the believers were revealed on the day of the marriage of Zainab, on the walima of Zainab radiallahu anha to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Zainab radiallahu anh, she was the first one to die from the wives of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And we know the story where Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, during his lifetime, when his wives had asked who will be the first one to join him, yani who will be the first one to pass away, and at that time Rasul had said that the one who has the longest arm. And what did the wives do? They started measuring each other's arms, and who would have the longest arm? Obviously it would be Sauda. They didn't understand what Rasul was saying. Of course, after the death of Zainab radiallahu anh, it became clear to them that the long hand did not mean physically long hand, right? It meant the one who was most charitable amongst you. And Zainab radiallahu anh was known to be the most charitable amongst his wives. It is said that Umar radiallahu anh would actually get frustrated. He would send her thousands of dirhams every single month, and only it would enter her house to leave the other door, through the other door. That's basically, there was nothing in her house. There was no furniture in her house. It is also said that Zainab radiallahu anh did not leave her house after the death of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Zainab radiallahu anh and Sauda radiallahu anhuma, it's because of how they understood the instructions of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam after the final Hajj, where Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that from after today, you will be confined to the four walls of your homes. And they took that. It will be the back of your, it will be the back of the grounds of your homes. That's basically what he said to them. And they understood that to be that they're not allowed to step out of their homes. Those are the two wives who understood it in that sense, right? And everybody else, Aisha understood it differently, and which was okay. And this again goes to show, differences of opinion existed even amongst the wives, but they were not killing each other or fighting each other over that fact. So that, she dies at the age of 53. Like we said, she's one of the first wives to pass away. She dies during the time of Umar radiallahu anh, and she is buried in Baqiyah, and he himself leads the janazah prayer. So that is briefly the story of Zainab bint Jahash, the one who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala married himself. And she used to brag about this fact whenever she was in the company of the other wives. She used to tell them, your fathers and your guardians, they married you off, but it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who married me off. So inshallah, with this we conclude the story of Zainab bint Jahash. Next week we come back with a new story of the next mother of the believers, and that is Safiya, inshallah. So until next time, subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun, salamun ala al mursaleen, walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Qad aflaha al mu'minun alladhina hum fi salatihim khashi'un والذين هم عن اللغو معرضون والذين هم للزكاة فاعلون والذين هم لفروجهم حافظون إلا على أزواجهم أو ما ملكت أيمانهم فإنهم غير ملومين.